Hey everybody, Tom Varnas, Stories from the 78. Yep, now playing the physician magician here at the Rhapsody Theater in Rogers Park. And that's the doc back there. He does his whole magic show in this wonderful old theater that's been around since, I think, like 1912. I'm going to talk to him about it now for this story from the 78 and what goes all into his show. All right, so I'm getting the doc right after a show let out. But Dr. Rosenkranz, how are you? The physician
Hello.
Magician.
Yes, indeed.
So we just got done with the show, and I got to say, it was such a wonderful show, very family-friendly, and it was just a very inclusive vibe. You did a great job with
Thank
making
so
people
much.
Feel
Thank
like
you.
They're a part of the show without pressure of being on stage, you know, very calm, relaxed, a lot of fun.
That's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to have a show that is different than everything else. I feel like I'm in my own little lane here.
Yeah.
Often people, when they think of magic, they think of, oh, you know, they're going to make fun of me and everything, but... No, I have a different message to tell, and I want people to come and
It was very
relax.
Much that. And it was, as you were doing it, it almost felt like, you know, kind of like your mantra that we were seeing on stage, just about, you know, centering yourself, being one with yourself, and like the philosophy, and almost like you were conducting an orchestra while you were in the moment of the show. It was wonderful to watch.
You totally get it. You totally get all of that, particularly in the first half. It is sort of a philosophy. It is sort of a way of thinking. It's the core of this physician-magician. You know, I'm the physician-magician, but the show's also called physician-magician.
Sure.
And there's a hidden prescription there that happens when everybody, we all solve all of these magical questions and mysteries throughout the show.
Yeah, and you get to see that all play out with the volunteers and everything else. And I got to ask you, you said you started this when you were about 35, and you've been doing it for a few years now, and this is your theater, so it's become a passion for you, yeah?
Absolutely. So my wife likes to say that she married a doctor, and now she's married to a magician. When did that happen? I was not one of those people that particularly was crazy about magic as a child. I liked magic, but I was actually much more interested in classical music. I was interested in opera. And my friends like magic. That's what that was a story. But as I tell in one of my stories, about 25 years ago, I walked into this magic store in Mexico City that I like to call the magic store of the time forgot. And there was this amazing man who had come to my house when I was a child, when I was 5 or 6, selling things. Interestingly, he wore a white coat. He wasn't a doctor, but he wore a white coat. And he started showing me these magic props the old-fashioned way, which is, you know, across the counter.
Yeah.
And then if I wanted to buy them, then he'd take me to the other side and show me the secret. And I liked it, but I really didn't know how it would fit in my life. It was, like, interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And then I met an incredible man by the name of Eugene Berger, who sadly isn't with us anymore, but he became my mentor. He lived 5 blocks away from me, and Eugene is one of the greatest magicians, literally one of the greatest magicians of the 20th century, and his legacy is enormous. You wouldn't know him, but he was one of the people that was training everyone.
Oh, wow.
And had a philosophy about your shows being scripted and written and clear, and the idea of the magic being very particular, and very importantly, that the magic needed to have meaning.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know.
You definitely have meaning. You can see it, you can feel it when you're watching your show. And you mentioned this magic store in Mexico City.
Yes.
And you mentioned in the show, too, there was a house that, was it your mom that painted?
Yeah, that's the house I lived in. That's actually a sketch of the house that I lived in when I grew up.
So when did you come to Chicago?
So I came to the United States when I was 18 for college. I went to California and decided that I wanted to study medicine. And so after college and a little graduate school,
sure.
I went to medical school in New York City. And then when I finished that, I came here to Chicago to do my residency training. So I started at Northwestern in 1990. I've been a doctor since 1990, and I did, you know, 3 years of pediatrics and 3 years of neonatal medicine. And that was my life. And so at that point, there was no magic, no performing magic. But then I fell in love with it. And the thing is, the part that I'm proudest of, this is amazing, and I love performing, and this is really one of my two passions. But the other passion is that I realized that I could use magic to teach medical students. And so I have the only course in the United States, the only course in a medical school that is a official, formal, you know, 4-credit course on medicine and magic.
Really?
At Northwestern, we have these humanities seminars, and so I teach the seminar twice a year. It's a popular course.
I bet, yeah.
And what we do is, I say two things. One, I say that medicine is a performance art. And so because it is, and because what doctors are doing in that space is performing, not acting, but performance in a much more sophisticated way to think about it, that performers who are really excellent at engaging audiences, you know, think about all the amazing performers, and we always all know when we walk into a show, whether it's theater or ballet or a recital mm-hmm. or magic, mm-hmm. we know if that performer is engaging with us. You know, sometimes they're in their own world, they're not sure. in the moment. Well, these are the same tools that doctors can use. So I bring great magicians, we show the students, we perform for the students, we show them how to perform, and we explain to them what we are doing to engage an audience. And that is so that the doctor-patient relationship can be created. And then the second thing I teach them is I say medicine and magic share DNA. We talk about all of those things that we have in common, which I talk a little bit about yeah. on the show. And one of those things is belief. You know, we create beliefs. Magic is about what I like to call belief engineering. Magicians are belief engineers. Mm-hmm. We figure out a way to have you believe what we do. And it's long lasting. So doctors need to create that. And a lot of that is created with trust and sure. with engagement in a relationship. So my students see how we do it and make it work for us in a show so that they can then make that work for themselves in their careers. And I love teaching that class.
Yeah, I bet. And I bet the students love going to that class and learning from you. And one of the things that I took away from that is a good reminder about empathy. Empathy yes. is something I think the world needs a little bit more of, because when you don't get it, you notice it. But when you get it, when you're not used to getting it, my gosh, does it make the difference, right? Like, and especially the doctor patient relationship, that empathy is huge.
So much of empathy is just the sense of being seen.
Yeah.
If you feel like you're seen and heard, it's so important. And, you know, I've been on both sides of it as a doctor and then maybe a caregiver for mm-hmm. like my mother-in-law or my dad or my brothers. And being seen is so important. Mm-hmm. So I talk about empathy the only card magic really that we do in the show, we talk about empathy. Now, not saying anything bad about magicians, but the typical magician plot with cards, very frequently the audience member might feel like they're being played mm-hmm. or they're not being seen.
Sure.
So I've completely flipped the script.
Yes, you have.
And my performance is about seeing and hearing the audience member tell us their story. And it is only after they've told us their story and we're seen that the magic happens. And
yeah, that's a great moment.
That is the subtext of, to me, what empathy is, which is what you're saying.
Well, it's wonderful that what you're doing here in Rogers Park, you're continuing this tradition in Chicago of magic, because magic, tableside magic, started years and years ago.
Yes.
Heck, the old Benny's on Clark Street was the magic castle years ago. So the tradition keeps moving north, and I love it. And I know that you have different themes throughout the year, or different magicians come through yourself, but this is your place, so you get to say and do whatever you want. But as far as the roster that comes in, or when people can find tickets, what's the best way for that?
Yes, so I am super proud of all the other magicians that are coming, because we are the only venue in the United States, really, where a magician can do a full evening show. You know, there are a lot of great magic places here in Chicago, in LA, but what they expect from the magicians is a short show, mm-hmm. a 20 to 30 minute show. And sometimes you just need to breathe.
Yeah.
And there are some magicians that have these beautiful long format shows like mine. So this is the only place where they can do that. And we've invested a lot in the lighting and in the sound and the set, the space. So we've had some amazing magicians that have been here. I have another wonderful one coming in a few weeks. The dean of the Mystery School from Las Vegas, he lives in Washington, D.C., is coming to do a show. It's called Magical Life. His name is Larry Haas. And all of these things. And then, you know, we also have music. This space is a space of,
yeah, it's a,
of
theater.
A lot. It's a great theater. Mm-hmm. And the mission, the theater mission, is to bring the arts to the neighborhoods. Because the city is not about downtown.
No, it is definitely not.
And in fact, you know, we have this great little line that we say in our pre-record in every show, which is we say, welcome to the Rhapsody Theater in Rogers Park, and aren't you happy that you didn't have to go all the way to the Loop for wonderful entertainment? Because I think the arts belong in the neighborhoods. And so that is what we're trying to do. So we have a great rock concert happening in a couple of weeks. It's the first one. I don't know much about it, but this is a good group, and they're coming. And then we're going to have some jazz and some 1950s, 1960s Supremes type group that is going to be performing. And the magic changes. That is my forte. That is what I know. And I have world-class magicians. And so the best way to find out what's going on with us is to go to our website, which is www.rhapsodytheater.com. Rhapsody, R-H-A-P-S-O-D-Y. So rhapsodytheater.com. And if you have any questions, info@rhapsodytheater.com or tickets@rhapsodytheater.com.
Thank you so much for taking time to chat with me after a show. You're a little tired after doing a show like that, but also you get that high from doing a show like that just because
I'm ready to do another one.
Oh, well, all right. Well,
let's play too.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much again for hanging out with me and talking with me, and much luck to the rest of the shows that you have coming up and beyond that.
Thank you. Yeah, my pleasure. Come back anytime.
Thank you. All right, so that's magic here at the Rhapsody Theater in Rogers Park. Tom Barnes, Chicago at gmail.com. If you have a suggestion of a story from the 78, head over to the website, storiesfromthe78.com. We'll see you guys later.